Hi, my name is Ricky, and I work for MS. I'm here to talk about the application that we have and the whole story of how we manage them, how we distribute them, and some features that only our desktop has. And I would like to start by asking who does not know about MS here? Okay, good. So MS is a company from San Francisco, and its mission is to bring the computing to the next 1 billion users, and those are people that usually they live in areas that do not have such a great connection, internet connection, and but you know, and because of that, and a lot of other factors, access to computing, information, and training, and all of that is even more important than, you know, checking your status on Twitter, I guess. So, yeah, and we do an operating system and applications to go with it. And Endless actually started by being an Android app. So that's a screenshot from the ages. The company is 5 years now, 5 years this year, and lots have changed, as you can see here. Yeah, then it was still an application, but one that was on top of a regular Linux distro. So it used packages, and with packages comes problems. Like you have problems with the dependencies between packages, you create one package, then it breaks something else. I think we've all been there. I've used Linux the past 20 years. So in order to kind of avoid that, but not so much, sorry, I have a cold. We started doing like application bundles. These were like, you know, there were custom bundles, so we would just have directories with all the files that we needed, and the operating system had the base, like the libraries and such that we needed. But of course, those were just that, right? It's just a directory, you just execute a binary and it pops up, and there is no sandboxing. It still depends on the OS for most of the base and dependencies. And then Flatpak came along, and it's the case for us, I would say. We were one of the first distros, if you will, to adopt it and to just use that as its major and only way of distributing applications. So basically, a few of the apps that we have, like I don't know, like the settings of the desktop, and actually like LibreOffice and stuff like that, it's still part of the OS for historical reasons, but all of the applications that we build and we distribute are distributed through Flatpak. Who doesn't know about Flatpak? Forgot. Okay, so Flatpak is a technology that might have already figured out now for distributing applications. And what it does is that it does it in a way that if you have like a runtime, like for example a GNOME runtime, that will have all the needed dependencies for you to develop GNOME applications, for example, and then you install that runtime, and on top of it you install applications. If you upgrade the runtime, and one application that you have installed still needs the old version will still be in use. And at the same time, it's not going to duplicate the size of the runtimes, because there is something like a binary deduplication that I'm not going to get into detail. But basically, it's a way to distribute applications. The applications will, by the way, be run inside the sandbox. So you can tell them, or they can tell you, if they need access to your home directory, like a calculator, maybe they don't, they shouldn't, and you can turn those off. Yeah, so it's like the shiny new thing, and it's cross-distro, so it takes all the boxes. Right, so in this talk, like I said, I'm going to talk about the applications and how we manage them, but I tried it not to be very technical, because all of the bits that I'm going to talk about, if I went into detail, they would be like for two talks. So, but I'd like to cover a little bit of everything. So we have a Flatpak builder infrastructure in place in our servers, and most of the applications that we still do, they're done in this weird way where we have Debian packages, and then we have this builder script that nobody wants to touch anymore in the company, and it turns those Debian packages into a Flatpak application. There are pros and cons to this approach, but that's what we have right now. And for newer applications that we have, but they're not the majority, we do things how they're supposed to be done, which means that we have a Flatpak manifest. This is a file that describes the applications, of course, the name, there's which runtime they need. They need the GNOME runtime or the Vdesktop runtime or the Endless runtime. They also bring in the dependencies that the applications need, because maybe they use the GNOME runtime, but they need another library, Twitter library, something like that, in order to run. That's all the manifest, and then there is this nice command called Flatpak Builder, and it turns that into an application. That's awesome. Okay, so if you do not know a lot about Flatpak, you configure your repositories of applications in a traditional sense. By configuring remotes. So the remotes that we ship now in our images are the EOS apps. That's a remote that will have only the apps that we build ourselves. It doesn't mean that it's only apps that we develop ourselves, because we have many games and other applications that we just build them. So those are the apps that we officially support. There's, of course, the remote that will have the runtime for those applications, that's the EOS runtime. And now we have a new one called the EOS SDK that has an SDK and the platform on just endless specific applications. The difference between the EOS runtimes and the EOS SDK runtimes, that the EOS runtimes, basically, it exists for legacy reasons, where we had to support a lot of these third-party applications that we still needed to build. Like, for example, some of the games use the Qt libraries and or KDE runtimes and stuff like that. That's all inside this big runtime called Endless Platform. But now, more and more, we're now Flatpak is getting into a good state where we can actually take third-party repositories and not have to build ourselves the applications that we don't develop, right? So that means that we have this SDK, new SDK runtime remote, just for those applications that we build, and you're going to be able to use that soon if you want to target the Endless platform. But this is getting more technical than I'm. And starting recently, we also ship the GNOME apps and the GNOME remotes in our images. And it also comes with the GNOME platform runtime pre-installed. So that means that we started already this process of, we have our stuff, but now these GNOME applications that are not packaged in Flatpak, they're in a good state, and we should do those. And soon we're going to get this thing called FlatHub. So FlatHub, who doesn't know about FlatHub? Okay, FlatHub is going to be it's going to be a build system and a hosting system, if you want, for Flatpak applications. So if you want to do your tiny application and you want to upload it somewhere, you do it on FlatHub. And that's still under development. Going to be a big thing, hopefully very soon. Now, for something a bit the apps. We have this internal jargon where we talk about knowledge apps. Some of us call it content apps. I never know what to call it. But basically, this means that we have a lot of applications that we build that they're just simply, if you will, like a reading application. So it displays information for you. There is, of course, the encyclopedia application that is, it has content from Wikipedia. And you know, if you're old enough, you remember that back in the day, we used to have these CDs with something called encyclopedia, I don't know, it depends on the country. But that was awesome. When I was a kid, my parents got me that, and I was very excited because I could, you know, look up certain types of frogs and stuff like that. And now we have that as an application. That would be the encyclopedia one. And then we have like a subset of that that we split into other applications. Others, of course, do not have content from Wikipedia. They have it from somewhere else. But that's the idea. Like, we have all these applications that try to teach about a subject. And this is extremely important to people that do not have access, or they have very crappy access to the internet, right? Because you say, what's the point? You want to learn about farming? You just go on Google, type farming, that's it. Yeah, but maybe you can only type on Google for like 2 hours a day, because otherwise your internet will go up. So this is the thing. We also have, I don't have water, but that's we also have external applications. These are applications that are proprietary and mainstream. By mainstream, I mean that, you know, everybody uses them, not only Endless users or Linux users. And it's Steam, Spotify, Dropbox. We were the first ones to package Steam and Spotify and Dropbox and all of this in Flatpak. We even had these before Flatpak could support that, which was a headache for me. But that's one. And now we have all these niceties for whoever wants to use them. Because, like I said, like, it's not like our users never have internet. Most of them, I've been told, they have some kind of internet, they have some kind of connection. It's just that, of course, they cannot be like downloading gigabytes every second. So they basically they want to use the same apps that we do, right? And using Flatpak for distributing this is actually just a breeze. Because I don't know if you know, but you don't even have like a Fedora version for Spotify. You have to like an official one, so you have to go somewhere else to get it. And of course, the Flatpak version of Spotify is not the official one, but it installs in one click. We also have this nice thing that is called Discovery Feed, and this is a new thing that is not yet released, but it's very close. And it's like you know, if you have little connection again and you have your desktop, of course you can click on the apps and that's fine. But in order to like engage more with the user and to make it a more pleasant experience, you can also have stuff like word of the day that we display like a dictionary or something entry for it. You have like art entries that you can check, like, I don't know, painting of the day, stuff like that. It displays apps that you might be interested in. So, and if you think that this all can happen offline, or it doesn't matter if you're online or offline, that's, I think, very good. It's a different way of engaging the user into using the apps and the desktop. Okay, so how do users in Endless install applications? You saw before that screenshot where you saw like many tiles of applications when I talked about these bundles. for a year now, we've been using different App Center, because that, by the way, that was like a custom or an app store that we built in-house. Now we're using a fork of GNOME Software. GNOME Software is the App Center for GNOME, and we do a few changes to it and, that I'm going to talk about here. So basically, who doesn't use GNOME Software here? Okay, so it's what you expect from an App Center, right? You can install applications, you can create applications, you can browse applications, you can search for it. But it's on the inside, it's built in a very pluggable interface. That means that the application itself only knows that when you click install, then it should install something. But it's not like it's going to try to do an apt-get something, because that's done by a plugin. So if you have a plugin for PackageKit, it's gonna be able to install your regular packages. If you have a plugin for Snap on Ubuntu, it's gonna install the Snap packages. And there is a plugin, of course, for Flatpak. So you might ask, so you don't need to do anything, right? Because there's a plugin for Flatpak. And this is, by the way, how it looks upstream. So if it has a Flatpak plugin, we don't need to do anything because it's already supported. But we actually developed an EOS plugin that is used to integrate some of the features with our desktop that I'm going to show you. So, like in our desktop, we have this icon grid in the center, where you can add shortcuts and remove shortcuts, create folders, all of that. So the way that you can add an icon there is through the App Center, and we have added this functionality where you can just click and add to desktop and it shows up. And if you do it in the desktop, it's also reflected. And that's a feature that it's not used upstream. We implemented it upstream, and it's just not enabled upstream. But this is, I mean, it's a simple concept, right? But for our users, this is, again, very important. Then, for historical reasons, we have many different versions of the Encyclopedia app. We have a version for Guatemalan Spanish, for Mexican Spanish, for Spanish, for Portuguese, for Brazilian Portuguese, for English, for Indonesian. And if we have it all in the same repository, or remote, if you will, so it will all display, they always have the same icon, so you would see like 10 versions of the same application. So in this plugin, we can go and we can say, this user is using the Brazilian Portuguese locale, so we're gonna block the other versions of it. And that's very important, so you don't end up installing the wrong one. We also block stuff that usually shows up in GNOME Software, like they're not desktop apps. Codecs and languages, typefaces, stuff like that. We don't show that because like for our users, they want to install applications, they don't want to know what a codec is. That's our problem. It's not their problem. We also use it to block a few of the apps that come from the GNOME repo. So this is me trying to tell you that if you want to develop or to contribute to GNOME Software, you can actually modify what shows up in there. Like for example, when you have the GNOME repo like we do, there are a couple of applications that don't work too well, or they're too complicated or whatever. So we can just, inside our plugin, we can just block them. And another one that I wanted to highlight, and this is a more technical side of it, is that we also use it to make Chrome work. So we have a Flatpak of Google Chrome. And the problem with Google Chrome is that if you run it inside Flatpak, when you do like Flatpak run Google Chrome, it will try to do Chrome has a sandbox on its in itself, and when it cannot run it, which is the case when it runs inside Flatpak, because Flatpak already has a sandbox. It says, it shows up like a warning saying, I couldn't run the sandbox, maybe this is insecure or whatever the warning is. And of course we don't want to scare our users. So what we did to distribute Chrome was to, we package it in Flatpak, we distribute it in Flatpak, so users click install, it comes from Flatpak and all of that. But then, when the user presses launch in GNOME software, it actually goes through our plugin and says, and it realizes, okay, this is like a special app. So instead of not doing anything and letting the Flatpak plugin take it and launch it from there, what we do is that we launch it from outside Flatpak. So you install it through Flatpak, we launch it from outside Flatpak. I don't want to complicate this too much, but this is something that you can do if you develop a plugin for GNOME software. Yeah, what I was saying. Okay, so UI changes. Endless takes a lot of care, I think, with UI and user experience as well. We even have two of our GNOME design team members here. If you want to talk to them, and so we try to make things simple, not only for like everybody, but also for users who probably never touched a computer before, and that's very challenging. So one of the things that we did was to, instead of looking like you saw before, like with the grid and then a couple of icons, and that we tried to simplify the interface, and we have a few categories on the left. That's actually going to change to be less categories, and then we have some tiles for the apps. So this is like the biggest change that we did to the UI. It's the front page. The tiles, then I'm going to do them, but the tiles, they have this nice effect where the icon shows up, or just falls up. We have the add to desktop thing like I mentioned. We also simplified a lot the details that show up in the details page. Upstream there is like a lot of, they call it like pills, and it's like telling you if the app is in your locale, and if the app is compatible with your, or integrated well with your desktop and stuff like that, but it's just a lot of information that was not very useful. We trimmed that down. Yeah. So, and we have all this, and of course, many people ask us, so we have our ecosystem of applications, but our idea is to scale this, and in order to scale, we cannot do everything ourselves. So last year, during WADEC, that guy over there, Philip, announced this thing called Modular Framework, and it's a framework for you to develop applications that are one of those knowledge apps that I talked about, and it's developed in YAML, so it's like a declarative language. And you can do apps like this. Like for example, this is the how-to app, and there are many like templates for displaying the content. So as part of the talk, I wanted to mention that you can check it out, and you will soon. Well, we hope that you will soon check it out and try to do an application like this. Okay. Coming to an end here, the future work. One thing that is very important is coming up, I hope in September, it's going to be the LAN and USB updates, or LAN and USB as source of applications. So the problem is that, like I said, you don't have a very good connection. It's going to take ages to install something like the Encyclopedia app, which is a few gigabytes. But those users usually have USB and USB ports. So if we've been developing this thing where you can just have a a remote and a USB, and you just swap it around. When you plug it, there's gonna be one new category that shows up there called USB or something. And when you click it, it shows up the applications that that you have on the USB. And for example, we have some classrooms in Haiti, I think, that have computers, and again, the connection is not the best. So when we have an OS upgrade, instead of downloading everything, every computer, multiple times, then one computer can do the download, and then it tells all the others, hey, I got this new version, and the other ones updated from there. This is very useful. I would even like to have that for me. A lot of UI changes, I think, are going to also get in pretty soon. This is a brand new, fresh screenshot. Sorry, not screenshot, mockup that Robin there got me this morning. So, of course, if you don't use GNOME software, you don't notice the changes that much. But yeah, it's this is like a sneak peek, I guess. This is another sneak peek, by the way. If you're interested. And another thing is that both upstream and us, we try to make GNOME software less heavy. It's a bit slower, especially our version, because we have lots of nice styles to show and all that. So we have it in our backlog, but we just have too much work to go and improve that performance. Because I don't know if you know our computers, but one of the computers that Endless developed was an ARM-based computer. So you know it's cheap. It's very cheap, but it's also not like a gaming machine. So things can drag a little bit there. And of course, we want to fix that. And another big thing, like big project that I think we're gonna have very soon is the promotion of apps. So right now, we have a remote that has many applications, and then when you turn on GNOME software, it goes and says, okay, what are the featured applications here? Basically, right now, it's all of the applications that come from Endless. Those are featured, it displays them, then it goes to the categories and it displays those. But that's not, that's, I mean, that's gonna be one size fits all, and I think that we're gonna do something where we can show, for example, if you're in Brazil and it's the World Soccer Cup or something like that, then we have an application for football and it should show there during the months where you have the cup going on, right? But if you're in, in the US, maybe you're not interested in soccer that much, so you should have something else. And then, other things like we now are having a big user base in Indonesia, so it would be nice to have like a Ramadan application or something like that showing up only there and not in a place that where it's less relevant, I guess. So this is, this is a very nice idea, and it's going to be, I know that it's going to be very hard to accomplish that, especially when we are in all over the place. The next and the last thing is what I already mentioned, like FlatHub integration. I think it's going to be, like, when FlatHub is done, it's like a thing, I think that it's going to be the year of the Linux desktop again. For real this time, and before the questions, I'll do a demo of Yenis OS and GNOME software, and it's gonna be in my dev machine. This means that it's probably gonna break. I compiled the latest GNOME software that we're gonna see this morning, so it's definitely going to break. Okay. I stopped having an image here. so this is the latest Endless OS, or Endless OS desktop, if you will. It was redesigned 2 months ago. Well, it wasn't the new design was implemented like a month ago or two. But like, this is, of course, if it was not obvious, it's based on GNOME shell. These are all bits that are part of the GNOME shell that we use. We have pandas, everything. And this is the App Center. So if you know GNOME software, this is very different from the AppStream interface. This is the nice animation that I was telling you about. And you got the start stop. Recently, we had a team going to Indonesia. They spent some time there with some users, and they told everybody in the company how they installed the Endless OS in a laptop that belonged to this family. The family had no internet connection. They had a 9 or 10 year old daughter, I think, and she started using Endless OS. And instead of going and trying to find out which games were available and doing what you would think it's the obvious thing for a kid, she spent hours in the encyclopedia application. So this means that, you know, information is really, really important when you have no access to it. Because, usually I would assume that a lot of 10-year-olds here, they're not going to go, oh, all excited on Wikipedia and stuff up, because they can just do that.
One thing to notice too is that you sort of renamed some of the categories on the left to make it more applicable to our market. We specifically stayed away from things like education because sometimes that doesn't, you know, for a lot of our users, they may not go to school and it could dissuade them from using it. And so there are lots of tiny design decisions that we've taken along the way to make it applicable for a wider market.
Yes. And by the way, so in here you can see that these are mostly applications coming from the GNOME remote, have no maps, no web. All of these, and they're integrated like seamlessly here. Then we have some of the applications that are coming from our remote. Yeah, and I guess that's it. Let's go for questions.
Of questions. A practical one, when you are packaging something with Flatpak, obviously you part from a runtime you define for your platform, right?
Yeah.
But say for example, a stupid example, I remember now, Picard, thinking that you want to make Flatpak, Picard in Flatpak, I think it's really, if you need some dependencies on libraries very specific that they are not in the runtime, they are not in the system, what is the option to integrate in this packaging as a dependency, Flatpak dependency, because it's a library, it can be shared with other.
Yeah, so, I tried not to enter into much detail of Flatpak because, as you saw, this is like a summary mixy thing presentation, because also I didn't know what the audience would be, the technical level and all of that. But, so the answer to your question is that you just bundle the dependency. So in Flatpak, there's no concept of like traditional dependencies like you have in packaging systems like apt or RPM. So you don't go and you download a bunch of dependencies, because that of course will get you like, okay, you install this dependency, and then when the other package needs a new version, then you upgrade this, and then the previous one breaks. So what it means is that if you need a specific library that is not inside the runtime, then you just bundle it. And by bundling it, I mean that in that manifest file that I mentioned, you usually specify very easily the URL where you should get it, the checksum, of course, and then what it does is that it downloads it, it unpacks it, and it compiles it. You can even add a script to tell it how to compile that. It compiles that, installs it in this in the file system tree that is part of the application, and there you go. And that's it. So that of course means that if you are packaging a library that is critical or sensitive for functioning of the application, then you should be the one that has the responsibility of upgrading that when there is a security issue. But then again, it was inside a sandbox, so if the library has a problem that it deletes the user's home and your application does not have access or write access to the user's home, that's
okay. Another question interesting to me is, you are talking about a lot of redesigns of the user interface. These changes are driven by just decision or whatever, or are based on user experience analysis and studies?
Yeah, so we have a grounding team that has been with the users not only for like interface design but for many things, and that always affects the decisions in the company. Many people that know those users because we're with them on the ground, they will help us take design decisions. So those are based on that, and we also have some metrics coming from the OS. Yeah, I would say that. I don't know if Robin wants to complement the answer from a design point of view, but.
Yeah, so we base a lot of our decisions on sort of ongoing user research. We don't do nearly as much user research as we'd like to, but we do spend, the design team all spends time in the field talking to users and looking at prototypes and asking them what they think about it, or having them run through simple tasks to see what makes sense or what things trip up on them. In the future, we're going to be basing a lot of our design decisions on user metrics, so we'll be able to look at metrics and say, okay, people aren't clicking on this, why aren't they? And tweak the design and see if the metrics improve.
Another Flatpak question. Just for make sure of understanding. So, for example, if I have one from my Fedora system, I download my runtimes, etc. Then if I go to FlatHub, I can use the endless application if I don't have a runtime available to install, right?
If you don't have one.
An endless runtime available for my platform, right?
So usually when you install a Flatpak application and you do not have the runtime, it looks for the runtime for you. So of course, if you do not have a remote where that runtime will be available, then it does not do any magical thing. But if you do, for example, now there is this thing called Flatpak Ref, which is just a file that describes an application and where to fetch it from, and usually it tells you how to get the runtime as well. So, and this is like literally like a one click, it shows up, and you press install on GNOME software, and it does everything for you. So, yeah. And of course, our applications are like standard Flatpak applications. There is nothing preventing people from using that if they want. Just configure the remote, and that's it. You don't have to have endless OS. If you do, we love you.
And finally, the last one. Have you choose a video editor for your collection of software?
A video what?
Video editor. Video editor like TV, like cutting live.
A video editor?
Yes, yeah, sorry, I'm Spanish.
Okay. A video editor
for your collection, yes.
No, we do not have a video editor, if I remember correctly.
It's PDB.
I know that
they
know. Yeah, it's part of the GNOME, yeah. But I was talking about like ourselves, we haven't like. It's part of the GNOME, so it should be available. But we don't have like we didn't get one video editor and say okay, this is what we're gonna send to our users. What's your color? I was told I had to give points to people. What's your corner color in the? There is a corner. There is a different color.
Okay.
What?
Okay.
Purple.
Just sort of one more question. I think. Do you want to?
I wanted to ask about updates. So at least when I was a kid and had dial-up, it was of course cheaper over the phone with the dial-up at certain times of the day,
yeah.
In the night rather than in the day, right? And I guess that this is also a thing with a lot of the plants in the different countries you operate. So is that something you build into as well, so you can update during the night, or do you have scheduled updates, or how do you handle
Some of our users definitely have night plans like that. We don't have anything special for dealing with that inside the iOS, but that's definitely in the plans. However, what can happen right now is that at least in GNOME software, when you click install, and you do not have a connection because you haven't turned it on, it gets into this pending list. And then, as soon as you turn on the connection, it starts uploading. What we have, this is like something I didn't talk about, but we have this thing we made different from upstream, where if you use like Fedora, what GNOME software does is that it keeps downloading the updates for you. It doesn't automatically install them, but it downloads them for you. So it keeps downloading them, and if you're on a mobile connection that is tethered to your computer, you will run out of data. Because of that, you may run out of data. We changed that, and what we do is that we display to you that there is an update, but of course we don't download it until you press download, otherwise our user would be very pissed at us.
So do you do a lot of those considerations with regards to like size of things, because people have the limited plans, or do you do a lot of those kind of thinking?
I guess this is more of a question
for Robin actually. How much of a concern you have with those kind of like plans?
What's in the plans right now is that we will soon have like automatic updates up to a certain size. So you know, if you have like 10 gigabytes, it's not going to automatically install it for you. It's going to be like a configurable Updates. When you click install, that's when it actually downloads them and installs them. Yeah. Maybe we do just one more question to compensate.
Okay. Sure. Question? Okay.
Couple of related things very quickly. I think it's interesting that you're not just making software, you're actually a content provider as well. So I was wondering, where does all the content come from in all these content applications like biology you showed us? And the second thing on updates is, have you considered using mesh networking so that you can share updates without having to go to the internet?
Okay, so the content question is that I think most of the content for these applications, at least the ones that I displayed there, is coming from Wikipedia. We do this thing where, for example, for the Spanish Wikipedia, we get like 80% of the contents of the most searches or something like that. So basically, Wikipedia, which is like a free source of content, we also have now some applications that display blogs in Indonesia. Partnerships with also with newspapers, so like Guatemala, they have this partnership with us. And then the next question about
mesh networks.
So we had a project going on for a while where we were trying to use NDN for like doing this. We have this notion of a synchronous internet that we're trying to implement. The thing is that it's actually a very complex theme, and for now what we're trying to solve is through the LAN and the USB updates. But definitely that's in the goals. Thank you. So what's your color?
I think it's either green or turquoise. I'm not really sure.
I guess it's green.
Yeah, it's green.
It's not green.
It's green.
Okay. And also Andreas asked
one. Andreas, what's your color?
Green.
Okay. Thank you so much. I think I'm overstepping.
And if you have any other questions, you're welcome to find endless people and ask them afterwards. So, yeah,
yes.
Content and internationalization questions and design.
So that row over there.